Today I'm looking at the AMD Ryzen 5 2600X unboxing and performance review. So I'm in the process of building a new desktop PC, as mine's at least 13 years old and was probably last upgraded in 2011. I'm now getting more into creating and editing videos, and was finding my old Intel Core 2 Duo E6600 horrendously slow at handling video editing, and it wasn't even able to screen grab in real time. So combined with some sort of electrical incident which left the whole motherboard dead, I decided to look for an upgrade. So when I was looking for a new CPU, I could see that the Ryzen cores were really getting good reviews and appeared to be a cut above the similar Intel cores. So I started to look for a Ryzen at the price point I was aiming for. I was looking to get a whole new motherboard, CPU, RAM and NVMe SSD for about £400, and I planned on reusing my graphics card and case. So this pretty much led me towards either a Ryzen 3 or a Ryzen 5 CPU. Initially I liked the idea of the CPU with the embedded graphics cores. Those are the models ending in a G, but the availability wasn't great, and the integrated Radeon Vega 11 GPU didn't actually score as highly as my GeForce GTX 480 did. So confusingly, the naming convention doesn't work the way you might expect on the Ryzens. The 3, 5 or 7 Ryzen CPUs refer to the maximum number of cores, where 3 is 4, 5 is 6 and 7 is 8 cores for some inexplicable reason. There's loads of detail that I won't go into here, but generally a bigger number is better. So one of the things that's worth noting is that the X represents slightly higher clock speeds as standard, whereas the non-X is exactly the same and can be overclocked to the same speeds as the X. But confusingly, the non-X also comes with a better cooler, so that unit is targeted towards overclockers. I didn't really want to go mad with overclocking, so I stuck with the standard Wraith cooler and the X model, which was also cheaper. So at the time I bought it in March 2020, I paid £129.99 from eBuyer in the UK, and I also paired this with an ASRock Steel Legends B450M motherboard, 16GB of Corsair Vengeance LBX RAM, and an ADATA M2 NVMe solid state drive. So you can see similar videos on those components over on my YouTube channel. So here we have the Ryzen 5 2600X by AMD. 6 core, 12 thread, 3.6GHz base, 4.2GHz max boost. Okay, so it comes with installation instructions. I can't get out. Installation instructions. The cooler. Cooler comes, it's fairly basic, but it comes preloaded with heat sink paste. It's interesting, it's round. It's unusual. Well, maybe it's not. The last time I built a computer was, I don't know, 11 years ago? Okay, and then we have the Ryzen with a sticker there. So now I've built my machine, I can give a quick rundown on the performance improvement I've seen from my old E6600. The first exciting thing is to open up Task Manager and find out you've got 12 shiny new cores. I then loaded up CPU-Z, and we can run a quick benchmark comparison, and we can load up the next closest thing is an E8500. As you can see, a pretty significant improvement there. And we can also see that if we get 2700, for example, you can see the difference there. And a 1600, not so much difference, but so then we can see if we stress the CPU we can get all of the cores to 100%, and we can see the clock speed ramp up. So then, just to show some of the issues I was having in the video editing software, I'll show you how snappy it is now. So I've been using Lightworks for video editing, and I find it works pretty well, but with my old machine it was nearly impossible to work with. So to move a video clip just like this would take 30 seconds at a time, and now you can see that it's instantaneous, so that's a huge improvement. So bear in mind that this is with the same graphics card, but obviously has the upgraded RAM, SSD and motherboard, so I guess it's a combination of all of those which makes a difference. So the encoding time's also significantly reduced from about 40 minutes to around 10, I would say, for an equivalent video. And then we can also drop into the ASRock motherboard utility, and we can see that we've got in here a number of clock modes, if you like. So we can switch up to performance mode, and we get a base clock speed of 4 GHz. That does also make a difference to the CPU benchmark. So if we load up those together, we can see we're running 3320. If we switch down, that drops ever so slightly. And then we can also come into here to load up an overclock profile, so we can change all of the clock settings and voltage settings. So I don't really know what triggers the clock speed up to the boost speed of apparently 4.2 GHz, but I can force a clock speed here of 4 GHz there, and we have to load the profile first, and then that will set it here, and we'll see an increase in the benchmark score here, 3.4 now. And bearing in mind that's still running Chrome, it's running OBS Screen Recorder and Lightworks, which is also using up some CPU time. And then we can go into the system info in here and see our CPU core temperatures. So generally I find that under most loads, even with a bit of video editing, the core sits around 50 degrees C. I've then got the fan set up to ramp up with temperature as required under stress, and we do see the core temperature jump up to about 75 degrees C, as it is now, it drops down pretty quickly under no load, and generally sits around 50°C. So considering that my case is pretty old, and this is the Wraith Stealth cooler, which is the slightly lower performance one, then I think overall it's pretty reasonable. Oh, so show us some gameplay, I hear you say. Well, it doesn't get much more intense than Red Alert 2. Thanks for watching, let me know your thoughts in the comments below, and if you'd like to see more videos like this, then like and subscribe.